My name is Julian Critchlow, and as you can see, I'm your chairman for the evening. And we're very lucky to have a panel of four distinguished speakers, all of whom are prominent in the referendum debate and incredibly knowledgeable about the issues. However, and I think this is very important for the debate, they come from diverse parts of the political spectrum. We have Independent Social Democrat, UKIP, Labour and Conservative. So let me introduce them. I'm going to introduce them in the order in which they're going to speak. Douglas Carswell entered the Commons at the 2005 general election as Conservative MP for Harwich and was elected for Clacton in 2010. In 2014, he declared for UKIP, won the by-election that he triggered, and was re-elected last year, currently being UKIP's one MP. Intriguingly, he lists amongst his hobbies making quince, jelly and jam. And presumably an outvote in the referendum would ensure that he won't ever have to describe it as fruit spread if it contains less than 60% sugar, as I believe a former EU regulation would have required. In 2014, in recognition of his efforts to bring change to Westminster, The Spectator named him Insurgent of the Year. The Right Honourable the Lord Owen is a doctor by training. He served in Labour governments as Navy Minister, Health Minister and Foreign Secretary, and of course was founder of the Social Democratic Party, which he led from 1983 to 1990. From 1992 to 1995, he served as EU peace negotiator in the former Yugoslavia. He's currently on the advisory board of the OMFIF, where he is regularly involved in meetings regarding the financial and monetary system, and he sits in the House of Lords as an independent social democrat. Graham Stringer, far left, is a chemistry graduate. He became the Labour MP for Blackley in 1997 and is now MP for Blackley and Broughton. He has served as Parliamentary Secretary to the Cabinet Office, as a government whip, and as a member of the Transport Select Committee. Apparently, he gained some notoriety when he became the first MP to call publicly for Gordon Brown to resign as Prime Minister. And he is a contributor to the book, What Next for Labour? Ideas for a New Generation. Daniel Hannan, far right, is a member of the European Parliament representing South East England for the Conservatives. He serves on the Committee on Constitutional Affairs and the delegation to the ACP-EU Joint Parliamentary Assembly, and he is the president of the Young Britons Foundation. He's also a journalist writing for the Daily Telegraph and The Spectator. He's fluent in Spanish and French, and so has been able to stand up in the European Parliament and be rude about the European Commission in three different languages. He became a YouTube sensation with a speech to the European Parliament in 1999, directed by Gordon Brown, entitled The Devalued Prime Minister, opening with the words, "Prime Minister, I see you have already mastered the essential craft of the European politician, namely the ability to say one thing in this chamber and a very different thing to your home electorate." He is the author of How We Invented Freedom and Why It Matters and Why Vote Leave. The format for this evening is that each speaker will speak for 10 minutes. After they've all spoken, they will answer questions from the floor. House rules are that no question must take more than 1 minute to ask, and only questions are allowed, please, no speeches. Please say whether you're directing your question to the panel generally or a specific member of it. And I know that this can be a very emotive issue, but please don't intervene in the debate unless you're expressly called upon. Finally, thanks are due to the Bruges Group and to Mrs. Elizabeth Clark for their generous sponsoring of this event. So we'll start then with our first speaker, who is Douglas Carswell.
Good evening, and thank you very much for inviting me along to be a part of the evening's entertainment, so to speak. It was sold to us as an economic proposition. When we joined what was to become the European Union, the common market, all those years ago, they said, yes, it might lead to a bit of a loss of self-government. Fuddy-duddy ideas like sovereignty, we might lose a bit of self-government, but look, we'd become more prosperous, we'd grow richer. Just look across the channel now. Who seriously believes that anymore? Being part of the EU makes us less prosperous and gives us less self-government. It's not just the crisis in the Eurozone I'm talking about, although I note that that has somewhat dented the credibility of those who said we would face ruin unless we joined the Euro all those years ago. It's far more fundamental than that. The EU is a pretty disastrous way to organize the affairs of an entire continent, a disastrous way particularly economically. And the European Union is not working economically. Remember what the world was like at the beginning of the financial crisis back in 2008. Remember perhaps what you were doing back then. Gordon Brown was our Prime Minister. There were queues forming outside Northern Rock. Well, since then, since the beginning of the financial crisis, the economy of China has grown by 400%. The economy of India has doubled. Even Brazil, which is held up as an example of how not to do it, even Brazil's economy has grown by 40%. But in the EU, the only indices that have grown by that amount are those that measure debt, unemployment, and particularly youth unemployment. That you might say, hang on, that's not fair. You're not comparing like with like. You should compare us to other advanced economies around the world. Okay. Well, let's compare how countries inside the single market have performed against countries like Canada, Switzerland, New Zealand. Since 1992, the advent of the single market, those economies have grown much faster than the single market. In fact, the per capita GDP of those countries has grown almost 50% faster than those inside the single market. Over the past 20 years or so, we've seen the emergence of companies that simply didn't exist a couple of decades ago. We see companies coming along like Facebook, Google, Amazon, Apple, even Alibaba in China. Many of these countries, companies have grown much faster than many of the old industrial firms. They are to the new economy what Volkswagen, Ford, Audi were to the old economy. But do you notice something? None of these companies comes from inside the European Union. Where are the European Union's Facebooks, Amazons, Apples? The European Union used to look like it was the future, but not anymore. It's failing, and it's failing for a fundamental reason, and that's because those who take the decisions aren't accountable to those affected by the decisions. Public policy is made by people who don't answer to the public. I can give you specific examples where the European Union has stifled innovation. Take, for example, the issue of clinical trials. Britain used to lead the world in clinical trials. 12% of all clinical trials that happened on the planet used to happen in the late 1990s in this country. That's an enormous amount of work on life-saving treatments, treatments to fight cancer, MS. Then along came the EU's Clinical Trials Directive, drawn up by officials and bureaucrats who simply didn't understand and don't understand science. They don't understand that often scientific experiment means you don't know what the outcome of that experiment is going to be, yet they imposed the so-called precautionary principle. The EU Clinical Trials Directive doubled the cost of clinical trials, meaning that today, little more than 1% of all clinical trials in the world happens in this country. The EU is making the whole of Europe less innovative. We can look at this in some empirical data. For decades, if not centuries, Europe has led the way in terms of scientific innovation, but we now see that there are more non-EU patents now filed in the EU than EU patents. By objective empirical criteria, the European Union is making Europe less inventive and innovative. It's a similar story of wrong-headed rulemaking, not just in science, but in the city, in financial services, in the insurance sector, in aquaculture. Small businesses have been hit by rules on VAT drafted by people who've never done business. Now, the EU isn't working economically because it's failing democratically. It's run in the interests of vested interests. Look at its currency, the euro. It's kept alive by sacrificing the prosperity of tens of millions of ordinary Europeans in Italy, in Greece, in Spain. The European Union means being governed by a commission that is unelected. Now, at this point, someone usually points out, hang on a second, the European Commission might be unelected, but what about the European Parliament? Okay, what about the European Parliament? In the 2010 to 2014 session, the European Parliament voted on approximately 1,900 motions. On nearly 800 occasions, most British MEPs opposed what was being decided. And yet in nearly 700 occasions, it went ahead anyway. That's not democratic. The European Parliament gives us a minority share in a peripheral, marginal institution. It is no antidote to the fundamentally anti-democratic nature of the EU. Now, many people like to think of themselves as internationalist, and it's a good thing to be internationalist. Internationalism is great. It's good that we cooperate with people from other cultures and continents and countries. But the European Union, Brussels, is not a seat of high-minded internationalism. It is the capital of cartel corporatism. There are more lobbyists per head in Brussels than even in Washington, D.C. It is because Brussels is home to many vested interests that big corporate powerful vested interests often like the EU. They often want us to remain in the EU. Now, it's not true that business in this country wants us to remain in the EU. There are good surveys that have been done to show quite clearly that the majority of businesses find the costs of complying with the single market rules outweigh the benefits. But I think it's fair to say that there are certain big corporate interests who favour Brussels. Why? Perhaps it's something to do with the fact that instead of spending their marketing budgets doing what most businesses have to do, what small and medium-sized businesses have to do, which is to persuade willing customers to buy their products at a price they're willing to pay, being in the European Union allows those big corporate interests to rig the rules so that the customer has to buy what it is that they're selling. Now, I've done a little research before I came here, and I looked at the figures for the first 6 months of 2015. And I looked at what the top 10 companies that have been lobbying the EU institutions spent. In the first 6 months of 2015, the top 10 companies, big pharmaceutical companies, companies like Deutsche Bank, in the first 6 months, they spent 39 million euros lobbying the EU institutions. You can buy a lot of lunches for 39 million euros. You can rig a lot of rules for 39 million euros. I'm not sure it's fair on the rest of us. Just look at some of the people on the other side who are backing the Remain campaign. Peter Mandelson, Goldman Sachs, George Osborne, David Cameron, the Kinnock family. What is it about Brussels and its tax-free salaries that attracts the Kinnock family to the Remain campaign? You know, there are a lot of rich and powerful people on the other side in this referendum. But I think we're going to win, and I'm confident not just because of recent polls that there have been. I think we're going to win for a fundamental reason, and it's this. There is an honest and honourable argument to be made for Britain's membership of the EU. I'm not going to make it myself. I don't agree with it. But it exists. It's honest, and it's honourable, and it's decent. But we never hear them making it. And that's because I don't think they believe in it. It's the sunken costs argument. They've spent their careers advocating our EU membership long after the rationale for us remaining in the EU has gone. And they don't really believe it. So what do? Instead of reaching for a vision of an improved EU, do you know what they do? They invoke doom and gloom to try to manipulate the voters into doing what they want. At the beginning of this campaign, they suggested that if we dared to become a self-governing country. What's so radical and off the wall and extreme about self-government? I don't know. Most countries around the world are self-governing. But nonetheless, they said that if we dared to become a self-governing country, there wouldn't be any more premiership football, apparently. They said that house prices would go up until they realized that, or down until one, they realized that perhaps young people didn't like that, and then they said it would go up or the other way around. I'm surprised they haven't yet invoked a plague of locusts and a shower of meteorites if we become a self-governing democracy. But you know, I think people across this country are fed up with being patronized by politicians this way. I think people have had enough of being spoken to like seven-year-olds. In fact, I was going to say like seven-year-olds. I wouldn't even talk to my seven-year-old the way George Osborne and co. sometimes speak to the voters in this referendum campaign. I think it's clear that the argument on the other side is lacking precisely because it's so weak. There's nothing extreme or radical about being a self-governing democracy. Let's vote leave on June the 23rd, not simply to free ourselves from those corporate interests in Brussels, but to show that we're fed up of being patronized by a political elite in Westminster who think that they can speak to us and manipulate us like that. It's wrong. Thank you.
Thank you, Douglas.
Lord Owen.
Thank you for a pleasure to be here. I've had a few stormy meetings in this particular hall. Where did it all go wrong? I think that's really the question we have to ask ourselves as we look at the choice on the 23rd. And I think it is very clear. People joined the EU after a good deal of controversy. It split the Labour Party for all through the late 60s, early 70s, and we had a referendum. If you think back to that referendum, those of you who can remember it, the present one is as different as chalk from cheese. It was a broadly open debate, conducted pretty fairly. Tony Benn argued on television directly with Roy Jenkins on the pro and anti side. We were promised that by Ted Heath and Roy Jenkins, that monetary union was a thing of the past, and people voted overwhelmingly to stay. And I think, broadly speaking, most people in this country accepted that choice for at least the next 15 years. It all started to go wrong, in my view, when they introduced the single currency, the euro. Let's be very clear about this. The day you decide you're going to go for a single currency is the day you take one of the most fundamental moves towards the United States of Europe. There has never been a single currency which starts with a multiple number of countries that lasts unless those countries merge into one. That is the historic course, and people know it and understand why. This single currency had a very strange birth. It was opposed by the Bundesbank in Germany, which was the strongest economy at the stage, and it's opposed all the way through the negotiations, and they predicted that it would fail. It was pushed through by Chancellor Kohl after the really magnificent achievement of German reunification, because he knew that President Mitterrand, at that time the head of France, was worried with a great deal of French people that this was going to accumulate much too much power to Germany, which became overnight the largest country in the European Union. And so he offered, when Mitterrand raised it, to pool the strong Deutschmark with the franc and the other currencies and create this union. From then on, we were on an experiment. Don't let anybody be under any illusion. That's what it was. For the first few years, when coins and the notes came into existence in 2002, It began to look perhaps if it might succeed. There were those who had always predicted it would fail. As a strong European, I'd already decided, I must say in my heart, that it would fail. And I helped create an organization of pro-Europeans who would have determined that we would not join the euro. Then when the global economic crisis came, the eurozone was hit, inevitably. But what was then very soon apparent is the eurozone had its own particular crisis, quite distinct from the rest of the economies of the world. And it has been in a euro crisis for the last 6 years. At every stage, the American Treasury Secretary and the British Chancellor, give him credit, George Osborne, urged the eurozone countries to change the fundamental structural flaws. And they have done practically nothing. The main and essential structural flaw is they have no way of compensating poorer eurozone countries or poorer parts of a large eurozone country with a fiscal transfer, which is the essential thing for any currency. Take away the jargon, fiscal transfer. It simply means what you in London know perfectly well. You're the most prosperous part of the United Kingdom, and for centuries, not just decades, you have found money going out from London up to Scotland, to Wales, to the northeast, and to the southwest, where I'm on. And that has meant that we have alleviated some of the, if you like, effects of global economy on the whole of the UK. It has been a more even society. It's been a more settled society. There has been basically some measure of sharing of the nation's wealth. And that keeps us together, and that keeps our currency viable, and it keeps our self-governing democracy strong as well. And it is the essential element if you're going to run a currency effectively. In eurozone terms, that means that Germany and Holland, the Dutch, the strongest two economies, but others as well, have to be prepared for their people to accept movement of money to other poorer countries, mainly the Mediterranean countries. And they are not, and they never have been, and at the moment you have to admit they never will be. This eurozone crisis, the former governor of the Bank of England has already made absolutely clear. It's a good book, incidentally, Mervyn King's book. Has the magic of alchemy in the title, which explains the mess we're in the global economy. But he makes a very simple case on this whole issue. He's not arguing yes or no to going in, and nor is it a biography. It's an interesting insights book. And he says very simple things. The euro crisis will go on. There will be a euro collapse unless they take the changes to introduce fiscal transfers and other structural changes in the euro so that it will be able to succeed. And without it, he and most of us have no real knowledge what will happen. Maybe they struggle on for years in this present sort of semi-stagnation position, unable to move, unable to get agreement. Maybe emerging is a smaller eurozone, nowhere near as large as the current 19 countries, and therefore very difficult to handle, with some countries being left out, some countries going in. We've already seen the problems with Greece, temporarily staved off for a few more months, perhaps a couple of years. Lucky if we do. And then you look at the big economy, the one that really you have to worry about, and that's the Italian economy. Look at every single parameter of the Italian economy. And if the Italian economy collapses, the impact will be very considerable. Ah, oh, they say, but we're opted out. We won't be affected. Forget that one. If you're in the European Union, you will be affected by a collapse. Then the other argument that comes to me from even friends, I have to admit, and they said, David, don't worry about it. We all agree the eurozone's going to collapse. We just don't want to be blamed for it. Blame, I say? What on earth do you mean? You mean to say we just sit there and accept it? That's exactly what the Americans want us to do. That's exactly what most other countries and international organizations and large companies, which depend on the sort of comfortable structures in and around the eurozone. Our responsibility is when you see a wholly dysfunctional EU unable to make the changes that are vitally necessary in the Eurozone to anticipate collapse and get out before it happens. And it is very much, to my mind, as simple an issue as that. Yes, the getting out may be difficult, but the horizons it opens up are huge. And you already heard a good explanation of what the world economy out there looks like. And it is perfectly possible for us. We've done it for the last 10 years. We've dropped our exports to the EU from 55% to 45%, and we put them out into the global world. That means we can continue on that track, and if we're outside the European Union, we can do it much easier. So this is the choice. You look at this Eurozone and you see what's there, a dysfunctional EU. You are given an opportunity in the treaties to legitimately come out. There is a transition period of a minimum of 2 years in which, if you adjust yourselves and handle it properly, I believe most of the structural changes can be made. Or you throw up your hands in horror at the whole thing and are afraid of making the change. And I must say, if you are afraid of it, I don't blame you. They've not only just thrown everything possible at us, they've thrown the kitchen sink as well. This has not been a fair-minded, level playing field argument about the case. You know, no argument has ever won 100 to nothing. Most arguments, if we're honest, are usually, you've done well. If it's 60 to 40, it might be even less than that. And of course, you rightly say, there is a case out there for staying and trying to think you can change it. But every time you hear that argument, ask yourself, how much change have we really made? And when did this whole argument become really much clearer? I believe when the Prime Minister came back from his so-called renegotiation with very little. Now, I tell you quite bluntly, Harold Wilson did much the same. I mean, in 1975, before the referendum, I'm not going to tell you as a member of his then government that what we came back with was a tremendous amount, but it didn't really matter. Basically, the issue at that time was to get the Labour Party to come rally round and support staying. That was the basic thing, because the Labour Party was split. This time, you would have thought the Prime Minister, sensing the divisions inside the party, would have stuck at it to get something really substantive back. He has got very, very little back, but he has conceded some very important things. No longer have we got, if this document lodged with the UN was to come into operation, which it will if we vote to stay and to remain, no longer have we got, will we use any of our veto powers on changes in monetary union. And he committed himself on a word of deep significance, deepening in the European Union, which he said they would not block, they would even facilitate, means ever greater union in all the things that matter. And I will just finally end on this. This dysfunctionality is not just confined to the Eurozone. We're meant to have now an EU foreign policy. Well, they had a go at coming forward with an agreement with Ukraine, which I believe was deeply damaging. No explanations can be satisfactory from Russia for what they did either to Crimea or to East Ukraine. But to enter into a diplomatic dialogue and end up with a mess that came out shows you that we are becoming dysfunctional on foreign policy. And the other area where we are becoming dysfunctional is now with this German document, which will not be seen until after the referendum, on a military secretariat. There is one thing every single American defense secretary and president up until Obama have asked of us. Do not, under any circumstances, create two military decision points in Europe. Keep one, NATO. We are now opening up the whole issue of European defense. Basically, it's fraudulent. You use the same people in the rapid reaction forces which are labeled EU or in NATO. But it is, in my view, deeply, deeply damaging disruption and basically a justification for not having a serious defense policy. So I ask you when you cast your vote to be brave, to be strong, and take a decision which looks at the future of Britain over a decade, two decades, and three decades. Do not be diverted by changes which might be difficult, but which we can manage over the next 2 to 3 years. Have your confidence back in this country. Restore the strength of a united kingdom with a true commitment to democracy, and let's make our own decisions, live with them, and remain a united, vibrant, adventurous, energetic country.
Thank you very much for inviting me here to Hammersmith this evening. This is my second once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to get us out of the European Union, or the EEC as it was then. I think this time it is possible that those of us who believe that the EU has failed will win the argument. I've been, as everybody on this platform has been, to many meetings round the country, both debates with people who believe we should stay in the EU and to meetings where most of the people are in agreement but want reinforcement and want the arguments put to them as clearly as it is possible to put to them. One of the things, and I agree with what both Douglas and David said in their terrific speeches, is that there is a level of dishonesty in this debate which is unusual in the United Kingdom's political history. One of the things that is rarely mentioned, David mentioned it briefly, is the renegotiation. And it should be mentioned, one, because the Prime Minister didn't renegotiate anything in reality, and it was trying to repeat the trick that Harold Wilson carried out to say that we had improved our position within the European Union. Whereas in actual fact, what that renegotiation did was prove that the EU is unreformable. Because at the point when the EU was at its weakest, because of the United Kingdom's political history and the major financial contributions we make to the EU, the other 27 countries want us to remain in. But at that point, where those other 27 countries want to remain, as to remain in, what was conceded? In essence, nothing was conceded. And I think if you want proof that the EU is not reformable, that is it. Now, every meeting I've been to, I learn more facts about the EU. I learn facts about the Clinical Trials Directive, which has taken 20 years to get to the stage where it can be reformed. One learns an enormous number of facts. But I have to say, I've come to the conclusion that this is not about how many facts there are that we can go through. It is a fundamental decision about democracy. British people naturally want to say, give us the facts and we will add up the pros on this side and the cons on that side and we will come to the right conclusion. I don't believe it's like that. I believe it's whether or not we want to be like the other 170, whatever it is, countries in the world. We want to be self-governing, and in the case of the United Kingdom, a self-governing democracy. It is absolutely clear that we are failing in what the Americans, as they often do, use to characterize a democracy. If you can't throw the rascals out who make your laws, make our laws, and who set the level of taxes, we simply do not live in a democracy. And that is the most fundamental point. The Commission is unelected. In fact, as is regularly said on platforms, the real qualification for being a member of the Commission is to have lost an election. To be an ex-Prime Minister or an ex-senior minister who swears their allegiance and loyalty to the European Union is the qualification. So, in terms of, Douglas gave the figures for lost votes in the European Parliament. If you look at the votes in the Council when it comes to the vote, I never get the figure right, it's either 58 or 60 votes where the United Kingdom have said, this is not in our national interest, we want to put it to the vote and we disagree. 100% of those votes have been lost. And that is where, after many negotiations, and there is tremendous pressure within the European Union to be communautaire, to reach a consensus, not to divide things, we have lost 100% of the times when we thought decisions were not in our interests. And this isn't trivial, that it is very difficult to count laws. They're not like you can count the number of people in this room today and come to an exact figure, because some laws have a large impact, and there may only be a small law when it comes to the number of words, and some are long laws and don't affect us. You know, if the EU passes a law on the regulations of olive groves, it's not going to affect many people in the United Kingdom. But the House of Commons Library, which is very good at trying to nail down these facts, says that if you add in the regulations and the basic law, 55% of our laws are now decided in the European Union by people who you cannot replace as your Member of Parliament or your elected representative. When it comes to trade, it's 100%. When it's agriculture, it's about 85%, and you can go through different areas, and those areas are moving more and more into criminal justice and social policy, areas that were supposed to be excluded from the remit of the European Union. So I think the democratic argument is the fundamental one, which is why we'll win this. But it is worth looking at the arguments that the inside put to us as reasons that we should stay in, even if they accept the democratic argument. The first one is, well, we might lose a little bit of sovereignty, but in actual fact, we are stronger with the other 27 countries. We have more influence. So I've just been through, and Douglas went through, the figures on actual voting. But increasingly, the regulations that govern sheep farming or banking or all the other activities that go in the world are not determined within the European Union. They're not determined in Strasbourg and Brussels. They're determined by world bodies. And so that if there are regulations on sheep farming decided at a world level, which there are, New Zealand, with 4 million people, sit round the table and argue the case for their national interest, whereas the United Kingdom, with many, many more people than New Zealand, has to be represented collectively by the EU, who may not share the same interests as ourselves. So our interest is diminished and diminishing. We do not have increased influence. The second reason, and I'm not going to repeat what Douglas said, is that we're told that we will be economically better off if we get into this slow 1950s arthritic body, that somehow it will help our economy. Well, you just have to look at what has happened in southern Europe, where the real nature of the European Union is that it is a political project which has brutalized a generation of people from Portugal, Spain, Italy, Greece, Cyprus, where all those countries have had youth unemployment, sometimes more than 50%, but in the 50% region. That is not an economy that is either helping those people or it is helping us. The other argument that is put, and again it has an initial appeal to people, is that pollution, environmental damage, knows no boundaries. So we should get together with people within the European Union and come to conclusions that help our environment. Well, that is a rational argument. But if you look at the reality of what happens, and again, we heard from Douglas that the EU is really vulnerable, or its nature is to be over-influenced by multinationals. I will just tell you one story, which has led to people in this country being poisoned and killed. You will have heard of the Volkswagen defeat devices, which cheated the tests on oxides of nitrogen. When the cars were being tested, they'd put into the computer a defeat device which showed that they were giving out less nitrogen dioxide and other oxides of nitrogen. When they went on the road, they increased the level of pollution. I sat on the Transport Select Committee when we interviewed Paul Willis, the chief executive of Volkswagen United Kingdom, who essentially arrogantly laughed at the committee, at those people who were concerned, and he said, of course, we complied with the regulations. We will not suffer anything, because they had lobbied within Brussels to make sure those regulations didn't affect them. So that in the capitalist United States of America, Volkswagen is down to suffer millions and, billions possibly, of pounds of fines for poisoning people in the States. In this country, Volkswagen are laughing at us because they managed to manipulate the EU regulations. Incidentally, the EU's carbon footprint over the last year increased. So I will conclude on this point. One can go through all the arguments, but I come back to the essential fundamental point. It is about people in this country controlling the people who represent them and making sure, because governments get it wrong, it's not just the EU that gets things wrong, the United Kingdom government gets things wrong, but there is a natural ecology of politics that when laws are good and they're passed in the House of Commons, they tend to survive, even after the most severe debate. If you take the minimum wage, when I was first an MP nearly 20 years ago, we were up all night, night after night, debating the minimum wage. The current Speaker of the House of Commons opposed it vigorously as it is possible to oppose legislation. But actually, the minimum wage has been accepted across the political spectrum, and now the Conservative Party is increasing it. And I won't go through all. One can look at legislation that the Conservatives passed that Labour governments have accepted. That is the natural order of things. The difficulty with the EU is that you cannot, once a law is passed, often goes into treaties, it is difficult to almost impossible to reverse it. So not only can't you elect people, it is very difficult to change the law. So all we have to fear is the fear of change. There will be change. Change is always difficult. But there is a real tyranny of the status quo. And the status quo is simply not justified. From the Enlightenment, people have always argued that ordinary people should control their governments. If we don't vote to come out of the EU on the 23rd of June, we will be denying that solid, long argument of pro-democracy since the Enlightenment that the rascals who are elected should be subject to control by the ordinary people. Thank you.
Graham, thank you. So, Daniel Hannan.
Well, Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. Douglas and David Owen both just made the very broad-minded point that there are arguments on both sides. And of course, they're right. There are some perfectly valid arguments for voting to remain. It's not my job to tell you what those arguments are. But I will give my friends on the Remain side one bit of free advice. Cheer up. Have we ever encountered an argument in this country where there is so much pessimism and misery on one side? I'm struck by this every day. It's not just that the Remainers don't say anything nice about the United Kingdom. It's that they can't even find anything nice to say about the European Union. All they do instead is threaten us with the terrors of the earth in the event of a Leave vote. It'll please Vladimir Putin. It'll cause World War III. It'll have ISIS delighted. And a new one from Alan Johnson yesterday. It'll mean that we never get to host the Olympics. I mean, what kind of people do they take us for? There is there not a part in the British character that says, don't you bloody well tell me what I can't do? Isn't there a part of us that, when being pushed around, becomes more resolute and more determined to stand up for our rights? And that's why I want us to use these next 3 weeks being positive, making an optimistic and cheerful case. I could stand here and harangue you for 10 minutes about the atrocities and abominations in Brussels. I could talk about the way the referendums are swatted aside. I could talk about the tax-free salaries, the 10,000 Eurocrats who earn more than the Prime Minister. I could talk about the obsessive micro-regulation of things, and you'd all be nodding along. And at the end, I can see one or two of you heard me do it before, at the end, none of you would feel any better. So I want to use my 10 minutes, and I want you to use the next 3 weeks to talk up this country, a merchant and maritime nation connected by language and law, by kinship and custom, by habit and history to every continent and archipelago. If we can't make a success of living under our own laws, trading with our friends and allies in Europe, but governing ourselves, who the hell can? We are the fifth largest economy in the world. We have the fourth military budget on the planet. We're one of five permanent seat holders on the UN Security Council, a leading member of the G7 and the G20 of NATO and the Commonwealth. We're sitting here in the world's capital city, a great, bold, spirited, multiracial entrepot enriched by the ambition and energy of people who have come here from every corner of the planet to bring their talents to London. Our language is the most widely learned by the human race. How much bigger do we have to be before we're able to govern ourselves, trading with our friends in Europe? And so let's use the time we have to hold out a vision of a prosperous Britain, straightening its back after decades bent double under unnecessary EU regulation. Of a secure Britain, which, in a necessarily uncertain world, has taken back control to mitigate the risks that will surely come, because we must be better off taking those decisions ourselves than passing control to people who may not have our interests at heart. Of an independent Britain, where we recover that sublime right to hire and fire the people who pass our laws. And of a global Britain, interested and involved in the affairs of every continent, including Europe. But a global Britain also that remembers its older friends across the oceans, in the parts of the world that are, in fact, still growing. As Boris Johnson points out, I think he was nicking the line from me, we are on the only continent growing more slowly than this one is Antarctica. And I have to tell you, that's no place for a country like ours. You know, we don't sit on great natural resources in this green, damp, exquisite island of ours. We have to make our way in the world by what we buy and sell. That means we have to be where the customers are. But as long as we're in the European Union, Brussels controls our trade policy. We have no free trade agreement with India. 9 years the EU has been talking about a free trade agreement with India and failing to sign it. Is there a country in this part of the world that stands to gain more from unrestricted commerce with that rising giant than ours? India is English-speaking, certainly for business purposes. It's common law. It's the third largest investor here. Owns more here than in the rest of the EU put together, Jaguar, Tetley's, and so on. We're the third largest investor in India. There are 1.4 million Brits of Indian origin, but we can't sign a free trade agreement with India because Italian textile workers and French farmers and so on don't want the competition. We don't have a free trade agreement with Australia. It's being held up because of a dispute involving Italian tomato growers. Now, the Italian tomato growers may well be right. I don't know enough about the details of that case. But how on earth have we put ourselves in a position where we can't trade freely with an old friend like that because of an unrelated dispute? We don't even, you know, have an EU trade agreement with Canada. We thought we had one. But now it turns out that the EU-Canadian deal is being vetoed by Romania and Bulgaria because of a row involving Romanian and Bulgarian applicants for Canadian visas. Now, again, the Romanians may have a point, but how on earth is it to our advantage to have our commerce with the parts of the world that are growing regulated by people whose interests are other than ours? Now, in fairness, we did today get a new argument from the Remain side. It wasn't all doom and gloom. It came from the former Foreign Secretary, William Hague, in his Telegraph column, where he said, we could stay in and reform it. He said, if we vote to remain, the next 18 months, the next 18 months will be the best opportunity for us to get a fundamental reform. What the devil does he think we've been trying to do for the last 40 years, right? That is the policy that any British government, Labour or Conservative, since before we joined, right back to Macmillan's time when we made the first application, they'd have all said, yeah, we want to get in there, get stuck in, make our case, build alliances, and then make it a more democratic, more open system, friendlier to the Commonwealth, more power devolved, not a federation. How's that working out? I mean, on what metric have we advanced that goal? With 40 years of getting it, the getting in there and making concessions bit, that's gone pretty well. But then in the turning the EU in a different direction, it is by any possible measure we're further from that goal than we've ever been. And if there was any doubt in your minds, surely it must have been dispelled by the recent experience of the renegotiation. Just think about that. David Cameron spent 2 years crisscrossing the continent, asking for a fundamental overhaul. The other member states knew that there was going to be a referendum at the end of it. And yet, what did he come back with? Not one power returned, not one penny off the contributions, not even a new treaty. All of that process ended up producing an amendment to one directive about benefits claims by EU nationals. That's how intractable the European Union has shown itself to be. That's how unable or unwilling to reform. And so just ask yourselves this one question. If that is how the EU treats us now, their second largest financial contributor, before we have our vote on whether to leave, how will they treat us the day after we vote to remain? Please understand. Please understand that voting to stay in is not the same as voting to stay put. Voting to stay in means acquiescing in everything that is coming our way. The assimilation that is now planned in the military sphere, the political sphere, the economic sphere. We can see the twin crises in the Eurozone and the Schengen area unfolding before our eyes. And we know that the European Union is responding to both of those crises in the way that it responds to everything, by demanding more powers for Brussels. And the question that we face on the 23rd of June is, are we going to make those problems our problems? You see, we do have other options. Because we kept the pound, because we kept our passport checks, we do have an alternative. We can reorient away from the enervated, declining, collapsing Eurozone back towards the rest of the world, not least our natural hinterland in the English-speaking common law countries. But don't imagine that there is an option on the ballot paper that allows us to stay where we are. The status quo is not on offer. Think of it rather as two diverging roads. One leads to a relationship with the EU based on a common market, not a common government. Such a relationship, indeed, as is enjoyed by every other non-EU state and territory that is geographically in Europe. Worth stressing, there is no country in Europe, with one exception, that faces trade barriers or tariffs when selling to the EU. Isle of Man, Macedonia, Montenegro, you know, Monaco, Switzerland, any of them, they are all part of that broad free trade area that stretches from non-EU Iceland to non-EU Turkey. The only country that has chosen to stand aside is Belarus. So whatever the future holds for a post-EU Britain, the one thing that is certain is that we will not be excluded from EU markets. And I've never heard anyone in Brussels in the 17 years that I've been there suggesting that we would be. Even the Remain campaign don't really, I mean, they try and imply it, but they're not quite so dishonest as to make that claim outright. So that's the one road, getting back our independence, free trade and political cooperation and military alliance with our friends in Europe, but self-government. But the other road, well, understand that the EU is not a settled dispensation. It's an evolving dynamic. Staying in means staying on a conveyor belt. And we know that all of the nasties that have been put to one side while we were having our referendum will come rushing out again. Harmonization of social security, harmonization of taxation, the European army that Jean-Claude Juncker keeps calling for every other day. He said it was brilliant. He said, you know, we need a European army, not to use it, he said, just to scare Vladimir Putin. Well, I don't claim to be any kind of expert on the psychology of the Russian autocrat. But in a list of what scares him, I would be surprised if he is kept awake at night by the prospect of Jean-Claude Juncker saying to NATO, oh, don't worry, guys, we will take this from here. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm wrong. But if we vote for that, you think they're ever going to ask us again? We will have given our consent in perpetuity. That's it. Now, that's the honest case for Europe, right? That yes, we're primarily now Europeans, we're quite happy to be part of a federal state or at least some kind of political union, and we should stop thinking of ourselves in national terms. There are people who believe that. They're keeping very quiet during this campaign, but theirs at least is an honorable, legitimate position. But what is not a position at all is the idea that you can cast some kind of qualified Remain vote. The idea that you can somehow say, I don't really like the way that the EU is going, but from risk aversion or whatever, I'm going to give it the benefit of the doubt this time. Trust me on this, as someone who has spent a great deal of time in Brussels, every vote to stay will be taken in Brussels as a warm round of applause and an endorsement of the federal scheme. Carry on, guys, you're doing a brilliant job. Keep going in that direction. That's what happens. That's what you're voting for if you vote to remain in. Edmund Burke, the great Whig MP and philosopher, used to say that a nation is a partnership between the people who have died and the people who are alive and the people who haven't yet been born. I was thinking a lot about the people who haven't yet been born because I had some happy news during the campaign. Shortly after the vote, we're expecting our third child, who's going to be born in July. This is going to be a rather... Oh, thank you very much. It's going to be a rather busy summer. What the late Roy Jenkins, your colleague, would have perhaps called rather a mouvementé summer. And of the many things that I hope for that child, one is that he'll grow up as the citizen of an independent country. This got me thinking about Burke and his partnership. You see, we're not just a random collection of individuals, born to a different random collection of individuals. Being a nation means that we have a duty to keep intact the freedoms that we were lucky enough to inherit from our parents and pass them on securely to the next generation. My late father was prepared in 1944 to volunteer to defend with force of arms our right to live under our own laws and our own people in our own sovereign parliament. I don't want his grandchildren to lose that portion of their inheritance. Another of his grandchildren, my elder daughter, is reading all the war poets at the moment. Her school is doing a great thing about the centenary. My old school, 749 boys of that school died in the First World War. She was reading a poem which I'd never come across before by Siegfried Sassoon, which takes the form of a letter in verse to Robert Graves. And there's a wonderful moment where he looks up from the hellishness of the trenches to a flare, and his eye is drawn up by the illumination, and he dreams on better things. And there's a beautiful line. He says, "For I know dreams will triumph, though the dark scowls above me where I go." My friends, this is about self-confidence. It's about self-belief. It's about whether we think we're good enough to flourish in the world, taking our own decisions. Look around you. This is the greatest metropolis on the planet. There's never been a better time to be alive and in London than now. And look a little bit further. This is a blessed country, never more so than in this season, thick and rank and green with May. The larks and the linnets singing in the high places, the season pulsing around us. Our story is not yet told. We still have more to give. And when you go to vote on the 23rd, do it in the knowledge that this is a great country whose song is not yet sung. For I know dreams will triumph.
Daniel, thank you very much. The only thing that surprised me a little bit about your talk was mentioning by what metric we have advanced that goal rather than by how many yards. We'll take questions now, if we may. I know there's a gentleman in the front there who put his hand up first, and I think we've got a roving mic down the front in the middle. Oh, down front, middle, gentleman in the blue. Yes.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Yeah. Please, could I ask Lord Owen a question? Lord Owen, you mentioned in your article in the Sunday Times yesterday what you called the ludicrous claims from government ministers that Brexit would be welcomed by President Putin. Yet what you said is simply not true. These claims are not ludicrous at all. This morning, I Googled material from many sources, which I've got here, including Newsweek and the Daily Telegraph, as well as The Guardian and The Independent, confirming that he would welcome Brexit. Brexit would destabilize Europe and make future wars between European countries more likely. Russia's state-controlled media are enthusiastically backing Brexit. Do you think Putin does not control them? Why are you misleading everyone with respect? And why are you being so unpatriotic?
Of the Soviet Union, which was a very dominating power in this Europe of ours from 1945 onwards, is a very serious one and remains, even in Russia, a serious one. But to compare President Putin and today's Russia with the Soviet Union, which after a long period of containment, we managed eventually to see collapse because of economic difficulties, is a great mistake. And I think, sir, a lot of your feelings are related to that true existential challenge which we faced. And the overcoming of that was due to a number of factors. President Truman reversing his decision to take the American troops out in 1946, a very brave decision. The Marshall Plan, which brought a fantastic amount of money from America into most European countries. And then the great decision by Marshall and Ernest Bevin to create NATO. And the reason why I wrote what I did is I believe the one thing that Putin still fears, and rightly so given the size of his forces, is a strong NATO. And the most damaging thing to NATO at the moment is this pretension that you can have a European Union defense force. That defense force is a joke and seen to be a joke by the United States because they are deeply troubled by having two military centers sharing forces which are really necessitated for NATO. And therefore, I think you have to face up to it. If we, as I profoundly hope, vote to come out of the European Union, we can leave the European Union Defence Force and the soft forces for the European Union continental countries. And we can and we must in this country strengthen our commitment to NATO. We have a long run. And I believe that hearing the debate in this country, seeing where many of the armed services have come out, deeply critical of the defense decisions that have been taken by successive governments, we took much too large a dividend with the fall of the Berlin Wall. We did neglect our armed services. Our Navy's size is a joke compared with when I was Minister for the Navy, with 200 vessels when the Queen inspected at Torbay. And now we're down to a very small number of military vessels. Our army is stretched, our air force is stretched. I don't want to go back to the days when, through very difficult economic circumstances, this country was spending 9% of its GDP on defense, when Europe was spending virtually nothing. But we cannot go on with the situation where we expect the United States to pay 75% of NATO costs. They will not do it. President Obama was right to say that we are freeloading in Europe. And what is needed for the next 10 years is a committed country in Europe that supports NATO financially and with resources and goes to the United States Congress and argues why it is essential that they do keep a military presence in Europe and to Canada as well, and does so persistently, and they get the feeling that we value them. The problem in America at the moment is they think we're taking them for granted. So if anybody thinks that our defense policy can be subjected to the sort of cuts that was done in the last big defense review in 2010, they are misleading themselves. And let it be quite clear, there is a choice, and it is to put more into NATO and less into European Union defense and do so consistently over the next 10 years.
Yes, gentleman, 7 rows back with glasses, red tie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Patrick Street, and I got a very short question. Now, nobody has ever really fought for our interests in Europe. And my question is this fight theoretically possible?
We'd like to take that. Daniel, why didn't you take it? Would you like to repeat the question then, the panel?
I'll enlarge it as well. Nobody has ever fought for our interests in Europe. Now, the platform has implied that this isn't possible. I actually disagree. I believe it is possible, but nobody has ever tried it. So I'm really making a point, but I'm just asking a question. Will you reconsider that?
Simon, I think. Sorry.
Patrick, I've spent my entire adult life listening to a succession of prime ministers claiming to be fighting for our interests in the EU. And again and again and again, successive governments have said that they're influencing the debate in Europe and that Europe is somehow moving our way. But this never happens. It's fantasy. It got to a stage where Tony Blair outlined the so-called Lisbon Agenda in 2000-2001. And he claimed at the time of the Lisbon Agenda that he was winning the reform agenda, fighting for our national interests, to the point where Europe had accepted, the EU had accepted the need for far-reaching and fundamental reform. And so he got them to issue this communique in Lisbon as part of the Lisbon Agenda, which claimed that by 2010, the European Union's economy would be the most dynamic part of the global economy. Not only did that demonstrably fail, but it was just the latest in a whole series of attempts by British governments to fight our corner, but to fail. I think we need to recognize there's only one kind of European Union on offer. We can't reform it. We've had successive governments try to change it, but they fail. This is our chance to get a relationship with the EU that we want. We're voting to leave the European Union. We're not voting to leave Europe. That's a geographic impossibility. Europe is still going to be there. We're still going to want good relations with our neighbours. If we vote to leave the European Union, I believe we can have those good relations with our neighbours. As Daniel once very eloquently put it, we will stop being grumpy tenants and become good neighbours. That is only possible by leaving the European Union.
Does anyone want to add to that?
I'd add only that think about how it looks in Brussels if we vote to stay. We asked for very little in the negotiations. We failed to get that. We then vote to remain in. And then we're supposed to say, oh, and can you now give us all the reforms that you didn't give us before? It's simply a fantasy. If you want any kind of different deal with the European Union, you have to vote to leave, and then from that position, we can sit down and talk about what kinds of collaboration, what kinds of power sharing we're interested in on a mutually beneficial and reciprocal basis.
We'll take the gentleman in the middle, about 8 rows back, with glasses in grey. Yes, you, sir.
Hi, thanks. So you just agreed that we're going to need to carry on with some kind of relationship with Europe doing trade. The island of Great Britain isn't going anywhere. So could each of the members of the panel please specify what model they see us adopting, whether that's Norwegian, Swiss, Canadian, or a new model? I'm interested to see whether or not you agree with one another.
But hang on, the way you've asked the question shows how silly it is to expect us to mimic any other country. The fact that there are all these competing, you know, the Jersey model, the Norway model, the fact that no two of them are the same shows what a nonsense it is to expect Britain to copy any exact model of another country. We will have a British model tailored to suit our own needs.
Are you able to specify what that model would look like, or haven't you thought that far ahead yet?
And a denial of what the case for coming out is to say exactly what it would be, because what we are voting for is not one particular model, but the freedom to decide what we want to do.
One thing I feel is really important is to knock on the head this absurd idea that we need to be in a political union in order to trade with the EU once we've left. Many of you will be aware of the fact that the European Union has a free trade agreement with Colombia and with South Korea. No one suggested that they needed to merge parliaments in Bogota in order to have free trade. Many of you will have an iPhone in your pocket. It would have been designed in California using chips from Korea or Japan and software perhaps from Mumbai or Hoxton. Do you really imagine that the people who produced all of that are going to want to stop selling it to you because we're no longer a star on the Brussels flag? Now, we would start, if we left the European Union, from a position of tariff-free, unrestricted access. That is what exists today. If we were to leave, hypothetically, at midnight tonight, well, at 1 minute to midnight, there would be no tariffs and no restraint, and at 1 minute past midnight, there would be no tariffs and no restraint. Already today in Europe, you do not need to be in the EU to have tariff-free trade. From Iceland to Turkey, there is tariff-free trade. In fact, the only country in the continent of Europe that doesn't have tariff-free trade is Belarus. Do we seriously imagine that the fifth largest economy in the world, we will get less advantageous trade terms with the EU than Turkey? Of course we wouldn't. Last year we had a £60 billion trade deficit. Look at it from the other point of view. They had a £60 billion a year trade surplus with us. That puts a lie to the idea that they're going to want to restrict cross-channel trade from which they are the principal beneficiaries. It is perfectly possible to trade freely and be a self-governing country. Most countries around the world do that.
Well, on that point, though, Daniel, you were saying that it's taken 9 years to get a free trade agreement with India. Don't we suffer the possibility of taking similar sort of time to get our own free trade agreement if we come out?
About 3 weeks ago, EFTA signed a free trade agreement with the Philippines. It took them 10 months to negotiate. What causes the delays in these free trade talks are what trade negotiators call the defensive interests of either side. And what are the big defensive interests of the EU? Agriculture, coal, steel, textiles. And these are not things that we export very much in this country. We're a service-based economy. We are held back by vested interests elsewhere in the EU. I gave some of the examples earlier of Canada, Australia, and India. Actually, the Canadian High Commissioner said to me, we would have a free trade agreement with you almost instantly. In fact, he said, we'd have never not had one with you. You haven't joined the EU in the first place. We'd have carried on. It was a very mutually beneficial system. You were buying our agrarian surpluses and our commodities. We were buying your finished products, and everyone was winning. I wonder whether it ever made sense for us to abandon a truly diverse global market which brought together service-based, agrarian, commodity-based, and industrial economies, where there was genuine pluralism, where you maximize the advantage of free trade because you could swap on the back of differences, replacing such a market with a customs union made up of similar industrialized economies at the western tip of the Eurasian landmass. I wonder whether that ever made sense, but I'll tell you what, if it made sense back in the 1970s, when freight costs were high and refrigeration was expensive and regional blocks looked like an important thing, it certainly doesn't make sense in the world today, where technological advance has made geographical proximity obsolete, where the internet and cheap flights and Skype mean that it is as easier for a firm in London to trade with a firm in New Zealand as with one in Slovenia or France.
We'll take the gentleman at the far back in red on my left.
My question is directed to Graham Stringer, and it concerns the voice of the left in this campaign. I don't think we've heard enough from the left of the spectrum putting the case for a free and independent Britain. And I think one key issue that we should focus on is the TTIPS treaty, which is going to give big multinational corporations the right to sue elected governments if they feel they are being unfairly kept out of areas of public procurement. All the opinion polls show that it's Labour voters who are going to determine this referendum one way or the other. And I'd like to ask Graham how he feels we can get more Labour voters to support the Leave side.
I think one of the curiosities of this referendum campaign is neither the leader of the Labour Party, or I suspect the leader of the Conservative Party, actually believe what they're saying. I know Jeremy, and every time that I have refused to accept the advice of the Chief Whip on matters to do with the European Union and voted usually in favour of a referendum or whatever the issue was, Jeremy and the Shadow Chancellor, John McDonnell, have been in the same lobby as I have. And you can imagine occasionally those lobbies are quite lonely. You know, there's Douglas there, myself, a few members of the Conservative Party, a small number of Labour MPs, and we talk to each other. So I know what Jeremy's views are. And I think it is a shame that Jeremy has been bullied by the combination of a majority in the Parliamentary Labour Party and the larger trade unions who took the decision to be in support of the EU when Margaret Thatcher was Prime Minister and have not really revised their opinion. I think one of the things that I didn't say in the contribution, there was undoubtedly some progressive legislation passed in the EU in the late 80s and early 90s, legislation that wouldn't have been passed probably in this country at that time. That has been used as an excuse by some of the big trade unions and members of the Labour Party to say that they would prefer to rely on a bureaucracy in Brussels to protect the interests of working people than on the electorate and active trade unionism. I think that is fundamentally wrong in principle, because if we come to the crux of two central points of that question, one is, should the voice of the left or the traditional voice of the Labour Party be heard? And I think it is a tragedy that it isn't, that the Labour Party, who's historically argued for more democratic control, is not arguing for that. And secondly, on the issue of TTIP, which is not really a free trade agreement, it is a regulatory arrangement of trade which will give more powers to multinational companies to challenge the right of governments to take decisions on how they spend money. Because if TTIP was agreed by the EU, then it would be not, if we were still a member of the EU, it would not be reversible in this country. So I try very hard to get the Labour Party at different levels to make that case. We're not at the moment helped by the BBC, who seem to think that the argument about Europe is an internal argument within the Conservative Party. It is not. There are large strands of the left, of the Labour movement, of the Labour Party, and particularly Labour voters, who are deeply unhappy about the EU. So we need to encourage that line of argument.
We take the lady, or it's a gentleman there in the middle, one, two, three, four, five rows back, with a red scarf on. I think it's a red scarf. Yes. Should be a button on that you can press. Try a different microphone.
Testing. Hello.
That's better. Sorry, we're losing you again. Spot the move
is it
again.
Working now? Oh, yes, yeah. Yes, okay. It's finally got there. No, I, in my madness, I actually instigated the EU law course at my university 30 years ago. And gave me a real headache studying that stuff. Just my question to the panel is, the government says Britain leaving the EU will create huge uncertainty for British business and the economy, but it seems to me that the uncertainty seems to be in remaining in the EU. When you look at the ever-expanding region, the ticking time bomb, the euro at the heart of the EU, uncontrolled immigration, the Five Presidents report, and as mentioned a minute ago, the TTIP trade agreement being negotiated secretly. I mean, surely there's more uncertainty in us remaining in the European Union, because there's so many things going on that we have absolutely no control over.
Okay, I think we've got your question.
Yeah, your question. I just wanted your question, your views on those five items I referred to.
Well, the answer to your question is that when a Treasury report comes out, you expect it to be able, in the true tradition of the civil service, to present both sides. And if they're making a risk assessment, they make a risk assessment of remaining, and they make a risk assessment of leaving. Now, they didn't do this, and when challenged by that, they said, well, that's up to the Leave campaign. And in that answer, they really revealed that what this is Osborne's choice of parameters to feed into the Treasury model, and it's a hugely partisan assessment. I'm amazed that some civil servants haven't broken ranks. And to some extent, lesser extent, I would say, the same would be for the governor of the Bank of England. Very interestingly, last week, one of the external members of the advisory panel for the governor broke ranks. And when he was asked, he said, the governor can say what he likes. I've got no complaint about him speaking. But, he said, this idea that we cannot attract investment is absurd. And this expression that the governor had used about we would be left to the kindness of strangers, he said in his experience, strangers make an assessment of risk, and we are highly investable, and that he could see very little difference between in or out. And gradually there is, coming into this debate, more and more understanding that the barrage of stuff that has been coming from heads of government, from international bodies, is all one-sided. Now, why is this? And I often ask myself, I think one of the central reasons is they do fear a Eurozone collapse. And they are trying to get us to stay in there and stave it off while they make provisions, as in the United States, to ensure that their economies are fine. Now, I've got no objection to the do it, but be honest. Come and tell us that you're doing your best to get Eurozone reform, but you understand why we are taking steps to try and affect and insulate ourselves from it. Now, that, I think, is the most rational explanation. But there's another one, and it's a deeper one. And this comes to the whole way in which being in the European Union has become comfortable. These large companies are the main people who keep warning you about this. They have vast bureaucracies in Brussels trying to tailor all the different regulations in their favor. They are basically not interested in open competition. They are interested in a cozy arrangement agreed within. And it's the entrepreneurial, young, active business people, smaller companies, that are prepared to face up to the challenge and want to face the challenge of going out to global markets. And there have always been this bureaucracy that has associated, it's almost a democratic bureaucracy. They're afraid of the real democracy being kicked out. They call themselves Democrats. They like the comfortable nature of this European Union. And we are rocking their boat. And it's also people who are, broadly speaking, pretty well off, comfortable, and see their own selves challenged. How else could it be that a social market, which I used to believe was going to be the saving grace, this is what came in the 80s under Jacques Delors to some extent, would really be a help for social democrats, has been just torn up in our very eyes.
They have tolerated levels of unemployment which most of us be absolutely ashamed to have in our own country. Over 50%. And I think we have to ask ourselves, is this the few at the top protecting themselves? And the more I look at it, the more I see around it, is a bureaucracy of the reasonably well-off putting up the shutters around themselves, unable to face new challenges, and wanting to stay with the status quo because it keeps them comfortable. And I think we have to challenge that.
There's a lady, 1, 2, 3, 4, rows back on my right-hand side, and 1, 2, 3, about 4 in from the from my right.
Hi, I just wanted to ask, what do you think is the most convincing argument that I could use to convince my friends, relatively youthful people, that Brexit is suitable for them and it is beneficial for them?
Very simply, do you want to be on the same side as George Osborne on June the 23rd?
Actually, you could do a lot worse than to amplify the point that Lord Owen was just making. Who is bankrolling the Remain campaign and why? I'll tell you, the single biggest surprise to me when I was a newly elected MEP was the extent to which large private corporations wanted regulation. Being elected as a Conservative, I was obviously very innocent, but I thought that they would be wanting freedom of action. I had that knocked out of my system within about a week, right? They love regulation, and the reason that they like it, it took a while for the penny to drop, is because they can easily afford the compliance costs and smaller and medium enterprises can't. And so they capture the Brussels system as a way of erecting barriers to entry, as a way of creating cartels, proof against the innovation of the entrepreneur or the startup. I mean, a very good example of this are the banks. When is the last time someone founded a new bank? It's effectively impossible given the way the regulation now works. The same organizations, by the way, which were so implicated in crashing the world economy in 2008 and were then bailed out effectively because Greece wasn't allowed to go bankrupt by the EU so that they got their money back, they are now literally bankrolling the Remain campaign. Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, Morgan Stanley, Citibank. So one of the answers to your friends is, whose side are you on? Is it the side of the general population or of these oligarchs and elites who have learned how to play the system and who have spent years and millions investing in rules that suit them and hurt their rivals? The argument that follows on from that is, do you believe in democracy? Right? Every other system in the world ends up concentrating power in the hands of a self-interested elite. And the European Union is no different from any other that's existed since farming began 10,000 years ago. But the antidote to it is having a system where we get to change the people in office. We can't get rid of the European Commission. We can get rid of our members of parliament, and that makes all the difference.
Can I just give one very simple argument that in debates I've always found to be the most effective? If the EU came along to you today and said, you can join the EU and it will cost you £50 million a day to lose control of your laws, would you vote to join now? And if you wouldn't vote to join now, why would you vote to stay in?
There's a gentleman right three rows in from the back, dressed in grey with a beard. I'd like to ask your question, sir? No, so you've just gone past him. There we are.
Hi, thank you. We all understand the arguments, we all accept the arguments, but we also know that winning an election or winning a referendum, it requires more than preaching to the converted. So to kind of shift focus a bit, how would you convince people to hit the streets, knock on doors, you know, bring the argument to the general public? What would your elevator pitch be to get people out there campaigning?
I would say to you, on Saturday, come and join me. Come and join those people in this area, in this part of London, who are getting out there, setting up street stalls and delivering leaflets. If you go on to the website, the Vote Leave Take Control website, if you give your name and address and details, you will get regular updates, and you will find it's a brilliant way of mobilizing people in your neighborhood who feel the way you do. And the very fact that we've delivered something like 50 million leaflets since this campaign began is testament to the power of that website to aggregate support and volunteers. If you haven't already signed up to voteleavetakecontrol.org, do it. And I hope to see you out on Saturday. I say Saturday. If you want to join me tomorrow, I'm going to be out there too as well. Thanks.
There's a huge imbalance, isn't there, in the enthusiasm and in the numbers on the streets. I mean, I accept, as I said at the beginning, there are good arguments for voting Remain, but I'm struck by how few people you come across at street level making those arguments. And I think deep down, it's because the fundamental tactic of the Remain campaign, which is to say, yeah, the EU's a bit shit, but the alternative might be worse, isn't very good at enthusing people. I mean, why would you give up your Saturday to go around promoting that message? This is an idea whose time has passed. Do you know how it works is that I'm talking and you get to talk a little bit later. Well, or you can shout and jab your finger, but that doesn't make you right. What makes you right is having a better argument. And I'll tell you why I think you're wrong. It's not because I think you're a bad person or you're... It's just because you're out of date, with the best will in the world, sir. An idea that looked like a forward-looking concept in 1975, when we looked across the channel then, nowadays looks like what it is. Arthritic, sclerotic, failing, undemocratic, remote and cut off from the people it's purporting to speak for. The world is moving on. All the growth is happening across the oceans. Why do we want to remain part of this collapsing project?
The traditional ways of campaigning, leafleting, knocking on doors. As Douglas says, the traditional forms of electioneering, canvassing, leafleting are very good and effective, and people should do it. But probably with at least 25% of the electorate currently undecided, talking to friends who are undecided and putting the arguments that have been put from this platform is probably the most effective way of doing it. We're all politicians on this platform. It's not news that politicians are not necessarily believed and trusted. But friends trust friends. So put the arguments that you've heard today, talk to people, find people who are undecided, have a chat with them, have a drink with them. That will really make an impact.
But Graham, what about this business of talking to children to talk to their granny and tell granny that she's got to vote for their futures?
Sorry, I didn't quite catch the question.
This idea that young people should talk to granny who doesn't understand these things and needs to understand that for their futures they need to she needs to vote in.
Yeah. Granny should talk to their grandchildren and explain their experience that actually, before we joined the EU, it was probably easier to travel to Europe in terms of getting passports. We still had Interrail, all the things that the In campaign have tried to frighten us about. Then Granny can tell people that actually the world before the EU, there were many things wrong with it, but it wasn't the end of the world. So a dialogue from people who believe that we should come out, the country will be better, people should talk, and Granny should talk to their children as well as children to their grannies.
The lady right at the very front, roundabout in the middle. Yes. Sorry, do ask your question. Hang on. I think you need to get the mic working. I think you need to hold it quite close to your mouth.
I'd like to ask all the panel, we haven't heard anything about the unity of the Great Britain, but how much do you know about the map, the secret map in Brussels, putting us into Arc Manche for the southeast of England, and how can you enable other people to know about it?
I'm sorry, I don't think any of the panel really understood your question. Would you repeat it?
Well, we know that there has been a secret map in Brussels. In fact, there have been two. The first one I know about put the England divided up into regions, with one of them called Arc Manche, linking us with France and southeast counties of England. How is it that they won't publish this map and let us know what they're going to do with England and with the whole of Great Britain when they assume we'll go in?
Thank you. I think your points are well taken, but I think none of the panel has a particular comment on that. I think we'll now hear from the young gentleman just behind you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to ask a question to Lord Owen specifically and Graham Stringer. I'm a former Labour Party member. I've recently left because I just could not bear being pushed out as a Eurosceptic within the modern Labour Party with Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell, who have both done a Damascene conversion and suddenly decided to become the greatest friends of JP Morgan, Citibank, and all the people that they've fought against for decades. And the question I want to ask is, especially to Lord Owen, is how do you convince social democrats like myself and young university students to leave the European Union when especially they're being fed? You have Monet professors who are funded directly by the EU Commission giving lectures, which I've seen, that are effectively Euro propaganda. And I think the elderly people need to know this.
I think the best way to handle this issue of Jeremy Corbyn and anything like that is to remember this. The man has been made leader of the Labour Party. He inherits a Labour Party with a whole raft of democratic conference decisions going right back to this period when they converted to Europe, which was really halfway through Neil Kinnock's period. And he comes to the view that he has to go with the main unity of the party. And I don't begrudge him that. So leave that issue alone. It seems to me it's pretty clear his motivation is to put the unity of his party first. He won't be the first or last leader who's done that, and there is something about it which is understandable. The question surely is this: why should a social democrat who would have been probably, like me, broadly in favor of the European Union over all these years, change their mind? And that, I think, is an open answer. Firstly, don't be afraid to change your mind. If the facts change, then you should be prepared to change your mind. That's what Keynes said. But I think it's more than that. This European Union has hugely changed. I mean, when the referendum in 75 was put by the Labour government, they put in the question, in brackets, common market, because they wanted to use the expression which most people thought of. That has moved on very, very considerably. I would say to a social democrat, arguably the best social democrat the Labour Party ever had was one who was never called himself a social democrat, and that was Hugh Gaitskell. Hugh Gaitskell, a moderate by any standard, was the first leader in this country to warn us about the underlying theme of the European idea, which was a federalist idea, a United States of Europe. And he won the support of the Labour Party in its conference speech in 1962 exactly on that. That was when I was just being adopted as a Labour candidate in the hopeless seat, agricultural seat of Torrington. And he has ever since then been my particular political hero. And I have been many things, but I have never been a federalist. And that strand is very authentic within the Labour Party movement, and it is not the province of the left, the right, or the centre. Like most political parties, we've been split, and it's much easier for this question to go on to the real member of the Labour Party these days. But I do think that we need to understand this. There is an idealism behind the European movement. I understand it, but I personally think it's never fitted this country. If you look at the Social Attitude Survey, which is a long-standing survey with very large opinion polls, all the time they show that the only support for a United States of Europe is at most 15% in this country. If people flew under their true colors and really came out and argued for a United States of Europe, they wouldn't have a prayer. And they do exist. They exist in the Tory Party, they exist in the Labour Party, and they are predominant in the Liberal Party. Michael Heseltine the other day at least had the honesty to say, we will join the Eurozone. It won't happen in my lifetime, he said, but he's 83. I mean, the basic facts of life are the direction of travel, and that's what we're deciding here. And therefore, you can come together, I think, as a social democrat with a very good conscience and explain why you think that we should stay out of this experiment. And if you want a really good socialist reason to it, look at how we have treated the under-25s in Spain, in Portugal, in Italy, and in Greece. It is a disgrace.
Sorry, do you want me? Just very briefly, Tony Blair really put the Labour Party to sleep on the issue of Europe when he said very clearly that the Labour Party would not win an election with an anti-European stance. And what I have found going round Labour Party meetings over the last 6-9 months and debating, discussing the European issue is that many members of the Labour Party are ignorant about the history of the Labour Party and its relationship to the European Union because it became a matter of faith. Gaitskell's quote that joining the EC, as it then was, would be throwing away 1,000 years of British history is almost unknown to Labour Party members. The fact was, until John Smith became leader, and I think there have only been two, possibly three leaders, depending where Ed Miliband was in his youth, who have consistently been in favour of the EC or the EU. All the other leaders, including Tony Blair, at one time in their political history, have been opposed to our membership. David was gracious and kind about Jeremy's position on the EU. I think it was just, I don't think it was party unity. I think it was just not being able to fight on too many fronts, and fighting the trade unions and fighting the Parliamentary Labour Party, I think he found impossible on this issue. I find that when you go through the democratic issues, the trade union issues, the fact that you cannot guarantee the progressive policies that happened in the European Union in the late 80s and the mid-90s. Labour Party members are open to that argument. The final point I would make, if there are any Labour Party members, as I assume there are in this audience, the Labour Party is in danger of getting itself into the position in England and Wales that we got ourselves into in Scotland. There have been a number of opinion polls done, and the one I remember off the top of my head is that in Yvette Cooper's constituency, a person I supported for the leadership of the Labour Party, 62% of Labour voters in that constituency want out of the European Union. And the Labour Party, Jeremy included, need to be very careful that we don't that we should address the issues of democracy and the issues of the interests of the poorest people we represent.
Can I say one thing very quickly as a non-socialist? We are luckier than many countries in the temper of our main left of centre party. You don't have to look too far to see parts of the world where the Revolutionary Party was bloodthirsty and angry and based on tearing things down. That is very different from the honourable left of centre tradition in this country that was always based on building people up. It was the tradition of the working men's libraries, the brass bands, the temperance movement, the nonconformist churches. There was a great sense that it was about dispersing power. And the proudest boast of our indigenous radical tradition has been that it took power away from oligarchies and spread it among the general population. That was the creed that actuated Wilkes and Paine, the Chartists and the suffragettes. How on earth has that system come to end in alliance with the megabanks, the multinationals, the oligarchs, backing the most anti-democratic, elitist project in Europe, where supreme power is vested in the hands of people appointed in secret, immune to public opinion, and invulnerable to the ballot box?
Okay, we'll take the gentleman right at the back holding up his brolly. If you keep it holding it up, they'll find you with the mic. Yes, you, sir.
Sorry, just checking if things working. Yes, can I ask the panel what they think the effect on the British economy would be if we remained in the EU at the time of a euro collapse?
I'd like to answer in part that because I have a house in Greece and I have watched over the last six years what it's like to see in a small country what could happen in a big country. And the first and important thing to do is for the last 3 years in my small village, if you go to the pharmacy, you see the shelves getting emptier and emptier. It is a fact that the large pharmaceutical companies have, by and large, continued to supply them with important drugs, knowing that they're not going to be paid. But there is a very vivid example of what happens when a country can't afford to pay its basic health bills. And then you see many other things. In the rural areas, by and large, they have got, you know, olive trees, a bit of a couple of hens, and maybe a goat or two. And they're somewhat shielded. But when you go into the big cities, Thessalonica, Athens, of course, Patras, you see a very, very different scene. It's real poverty, stark unemployment, and a very demoralized. And you have seen the growth of one of the unattractive right-wing movements that comes up with it, contained by police and with all the sort of problems that you see of this type of force. And you see its percentage support growing. Now, this is what then also is, you see the economy flat, the unemployed youngsters kicking around in the streets. This is in the rural areas as well as the city areas. Nothing to do, no prospects. Training programs virtually non-existent. And you then start to see also a good deal of leaving the country and the young go. Greeks have been doing that traditionally over the decades. But it's a very demoralizing process. Then go to Spain, which I did. And there again, you see exactly the same thing. And we have got to be very careful about this. There was a very unattractive incident in Germany where there was some very nasty abuse of women. And what was worrying about it was not reported in the newspapers and the police force connived in shutting it down. Now, we've got to be very honest with ourselves about this. We in this country had a very nasty, aggressive nationalist grouping, the BNP. This was fought down, largely, it has to be said, by the left, by Labour Party. And in constituency after constituency, where it started to grow up, they started to take them on in debate, in democratic debate, go to their meetings, not stop them and dialogue with them at the factory floor and things like that. And that has been broadly gone. And I do want to say this one thing. I very much resent the representation of UKIP as being the same as the other right-wing movements that are extremely ugly. And it's a pleasure to be on a platform with a person who resigned his seat, went out and fought a by-election, put his whole career on the record, won, and then won again in the general election that came after it. And I... And on Friday, in my own constituency and home of Plymouth, I shared a platform with a UKIP, the deputy leader and an expert in trade, who happens to have been at Harvard Business School, and he gave the best explanation I've yet heard of all the trading opportunities around the world, and it was good and pleasant to hear, and we've joined together in some website to put out some of these trade arguments. So I think we need to recognize this, and particularly people like me, who I don't, until the Euro, I would not have dreamt of being an outer. And I think we need to recognize that there were people here who used the democratic means to found a small party, to lead it forwards, to fight for the referendum. You've never had this referendum because of the political parties, any of the three big political parties. It's been fought for by you, the people, and you've had the ability to create a pressure movement and then to create it as a political party. And so I think we can be reasonably happy with the way we have dealt with this debate in this country. It's shown the strength of our democracy. But I will not live with this idea of depicting UKIP as a disreputable, right-wing, nationalist, fascist party. It is not. It is a genuine expression of unrest. And I would like to say one other thing. One of the things that I've got most upset about, and it's over a long political career, and it started in dealing with Commonwealth immigration right back in the late 50s, early 60s. A lot of people have been affected by immigration. They've seen their children unable to go to their first choice of primary school. They've seen their casualty and accident services overstretched by high immigration concentrated in certain parts of the country. We've never been able to spread it more evenly across the whole country. And there are whole communities that have been changed and been affected by this. And many of these people have been very afraid to talk about their concerns for fear that they should be labeled as racist. We have a huge responsibility to recognize. For decades now, we have not handled this issue of immigration properly. Those of us who believe that immigration does add to the overall wealth of the country have a huge responsibility to try and repair that damage, that social damage that has been done in these areas. And I think that it's very encouraging that this grouping that has come together to fight to leave, with all these different political things, has been able to reach agreement on trying to put more money into those NHS and housing and education in these areas. It's even dealt and formed a measure of agreement on TTIP. We've been in an extremely interesting coalition across the board. We're not yet quite there in terms of giving enough weight to Labour voters, who could be the most crucial element in this election. But it's a very welcoming grouping of people who are working together, and I'm very encouraged by it.
Any final comment from the panel before we land up? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid it's...
That's the end. Can I just make one advertisement, which is, for those of you who have been convinced by what you've heard, if you want the full case, Why Vote Leave is available outside. I'll be happy to sign and dedicate it. I wish I had £9.3 million of taxpayers' money to send it out for nothing, but sadly, I'm obliged to put it on sale, but it is available for £10. That's for those of you who have been convinced. Those of you who are planning to vote the other way, not very much happening on the 23rd of June. Go and have a nice holiday.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all very much for coming along. And please do thank the speakers in the usual way.